Once upon a time in Paris, a wine seller tried to sell me a bottle of wine. And he said to me, "Do you want to know what the secret of life is? If you buy a bottle of my wine, I tell you." So I said, "Go on," gave him the money. And you know what he told me? Well, stay tuned to the end, because it is the whole point of this video. So the BMW M4, which is like a coupe version of the M3, if you're not that clued up on cars, and the CS version. So what have we got in the F82 M4? We've got the first iteration of the M4, then we have the M4 Comp, then one up from that you have the M4CS, and then one up from the M4CS, if you like, is the GTS, which is a real track-derived car. So the first thing to understand about this is it sits somewhere between the full-on GTS and the M4 Comp. So let's go through some of the specs. We've got a 3-litre S55. Apologies if I got the designator wrong, the engine number wrong. I think it's S55. I'll get some grief for that. 3-litre twin turbo engine producing 460 brake horsepower, which it puts through the rear wheels only, which is a rare thing. It's capable of doing 0 to 60 in 3.9 seconds, which is phenomenal performance for this type of car with this type of with rear wheel drive. The fuel consumption of the car is bad. I'm not going to give you the figures. If you're worried about that, then you're going to be not the sort of person that buys this car. You're going to be like an eco warrior or like a climate heating up Greta type how dare you character. So we won't go into that. The car weighs about 1,550 kilos, so the important thing is a lot of weight reduction, which we'll go on and tell you about, has gone on in this car, which is part of the reason it's expensive, which moves us on to the next thing, the price. The list price of these new, when they first come out, was around 90 to 110,000, depending on what you spec. And there's some little things within it you can spec, like the Alcantara steering wheel, the heads-up display. But I believe, as standard, they came with obviously the carbon roof, the carbon fibre front bonnet, plastic boot lid, some carbon splitters. These interior, they look a bit like carbon, but some sort of compressed fibre. I've got no idea it is, with these jockstrap type handles rather than normal door handles, all in the name of getting weight down. You get no interior armrest, you get no normal speakers in the doors and all that, so you just get a terrible speaker in the middle and the sound system on the car is not great, all to save weight. However, you do get things like electric heated seats and electric seats, which probably add weight. So there's some hardcore things, some not so hardcore things. Car also comes with a 7-speed DCT, which is double or dual clutch transmission, which is a very fast gearbox, and even the speed of it is configurable between three settings, S1 through to S3, if you want to use the flappy paddles, or just an automatic mode where it does it by itself. Okay, it comes with either Michelin Pilot Sport tyres, boo, they've been discontinued and they're all right, but they're not that great, or Cup 2, yay, more track orientated tyres for the hardcore petrol head amongst you, which is going to be anyone buying this car. My car's running Pilot Sport 4S's, which is a option you can now pick, which is a good in-between option between the poor Michelin Pilot Supersports or the not so great ones and the Cup 2's. It has forged aluminium lightweight suspension on it. What else has it got? Titanium exhaust. It achieves 7.38 on the Nürburgring, which is ridiculous really for this type of car, because the times are just getting faster and faster. It, as well as the dual clutch transmission, it has BMW's DSC traction control system and an M Sport active differential, which is also, you can kind of switch on, which creates like a drift mode type of thing. So that's probably the mode that lots of us will use, or traction control off if you've got a really hairy chest. and big hands. Okay, lightweight forged alloys, 19 at the front by I think 265 and 35. So it's a BMW classic staggered setup, and on the rear you've got 20, so it's 285 by 30 by 20 inch alloys. So it's a staggered setup with even larger alloys on the rear, so big wide tires as well to help put down some of that considerable power. You've got lots of Alcantara in the middle, woeful Stezza as I talked about, the heads up display, which I personally was first very impressed with, and then after running it for a while started to find it a bit annoying, and I tend to turn it off now. It's the sort of thing you might turn on if you're doing track driving. Another cool thing about this car, it comes with the adaptive LED headlights at the front, which you've got the lovely modern hexagonal thing as opposed to the rings, the circles, which look a bit dated. And the rear tail lights have got this really strange but awesome little set of LED discs, like disc plates, and they all line up and they turn on like a sort of snake and light down, and they're really cool little touches like that, along with all of the subtle carbon fiber little boot lid lip or spoiler, if you like, the diffuser, the front carbon fiber spoiler, and the full carbon fiber bonnet make this car, I think, stand out from the normal M4 a little bit more, and I like the look of the forged alloys. My car also comes with ceramic brakes, which are great in terms of stopping performance and wear rates for normal driving, but cost an absolute arm and a leg if you ever have to replace them. Okay, I think that's all the spec stuff covered. What we need to do now is get out on the road, drive this, and tell you what is at the heart of this particular car. Okay, let's start with, you've got three main configurables here, guys. Steering, so you can have in comfort, sport, or sport plus. I like sport plus because I feel that's set up just about how I like it. You can have your spring rate, your dampening set up for comfort, sport, or sport plus. Sport I have on my M1 setting, which I'll talk about in a second. And sport plus suspension I'd use for track use. Comfort if you're doing a long journey, maybe. And then your engine mapping or your throttle response, efficient, so you save petrol. Don't use that one. Or sport plus. Now, beyond just being able to play around with those, and of course your traction control settings, so you can turn off BMW's DSC, its traction control, and if you press that traction control off, it turns on, I believe, the M Sport differential, which is like some sort of fake drift mode, I don't know. Or you could hold down the traction control off and turn all traction control fully off. You have two configurable buttons, M1, M2, where you can store your configuration so you don't have to keep messing around with them. So M1 I run in sport mode on throttle, sport mode on suspension, and sport plus on steering, so like the heavy steering wheel. You can also configure the speed at which your gearbox, your dual clutch transmission changes. So I tend to run that on 2 for my road setting and 3 for my track setting. Anyway, you can play around with those to your heart's content, guys, but it's really nice to be able to switch between one and the other. Now I'm just switching to sport SM2 mode, where I have everything in maximum setting and traction control fully off so I can feel the car. Now, before we go on to talking about that, the suspension on this car, I believe, is set up, obviously set up aggressively, but it's set up really, really nice. The dampening in the comfort mode is good for most well-maintained roads. If you put it in Sport Plus, it does become a little bit brutal. Sports, yes, it's the middle ground. I will say that the difference between all of these modes is quite subtle, actually, and they've set it up quite right. And we've got horrible light, so I'm gonna stop this section and wait for the light to sort itself out. Let's cover acceleration. Whoa. Okay. We're trying to stay under the speed limits here. It's brutal, and if you're going foot to the floor, you will feel things going on at the back that on a road are quite scary, but that's part of the fun. This car has so much power, it struggles to put it down. And if you run it in Sports Plus, it even becomes unsettled and you can get a little bit of kangarooing. So I'm going to redo that in Sports Plus now. Okay, let's just slow down. And now we're going to go with deep acceleration. Whoa, there it goes. Whoa. And that's with traction control off. And I can feel when that power kicks in and the turbos are going, it's got so much power that the rear really struggles to put it down, especially in a cold day with greasy conditions, and you feel a bit of squirming around the back. So you really need like a nice warm day where the tires are warmed up and smooth conditions on a track to really utilize Sports Plus on this car. Most of the time on the road, you are better in a sport setting. So that's a bit of good consumer advice there for you. So guys, the next thing, the handling. BMW always tend to get this right. This car's light, it's well balanced, it's got very wide, sticky Michelin tires on it. And when you put it through corners, unless you're being stupid on the throttle or going ludicrous speeds, the car behaves really well. If you get on the throttle too early, which is quite easy to do, then you're going to feel the back move around, and yes, it can snap out and kick out on you. So that's part of the BMW thing, and that's part of the 400 and God knows how many brake horsepower rear wheel drive thing. Next thing, guys, is the anchors on this car. Well, I'm running the carbon ceramic, the £8,000 option that should last the lifetime of the car, but, well, God knows how long, but you should get your money's worth out of these carbon ceramic brakes, which is good, because I'm told to replace all the pads and the discs will cost you around £7,000 or £8,000, which is more than my E36 is worth. So I'm gonna try and preserve these brakes, and as always, get my money out of them. The crunch test is, how do these carbon ceramics wear on track? The answer, I do not know yet. But the brakes feel really, really sharp, really responsive without being grabby. And the great advantage of the carbon ceramics is they don't plaster your car in brake dust, so they're really easy to maintain. You can almost just foam them up and wash them off. But this is not a detailing video. The brakes get a massive thumbs up. Okay guys, what are all the negatives and positives with this car generally? Well, the first thing that any competent review has to cover is the price. This thing, when it was new, cost around 90 to 110,000, which was a hell of a lot more money than a normal sort of M4 comp. You know, let's say that could be about 60,000, something like that, depending on how you spec it. So, you know, getting close to twice the price for some tiny extra bits of performance and some sort of reductions in luxury, you know, with a Stezza and the door cards and all that sort of thing. So you pay a lot for that little bit of hardcore added CS-ness. The next thing is, this car truly does have too much power. Forgive the horrible exposure. The sun is beaming down today. The car really does have too much power for a rear-wheel drive car, and it's at the limit of what is even viable. And you can see now why BMW kind of moved to an xDrive system option on their kind of new M3 and M4, because this might be a little bit too much for some people, and rightly so. The second main issue I have with this car is, in Sports Plus, there can be a tendency for the car to kangaroo if you don't really commit to the throttle pedal. And really committing to the throttle pedal, even with your traction control on, can get you in trouble with this. So Sports Plus isn't always viable to use on the road, which is a little bit dangerous perhaps, although, you know, you've got control over that and you've got to apply common sense with this car. I have, in terms of niggles, I have an exhaust rattle on startup, which I can find annoying. It's not doing it at all today, which is bizarre, but some days it's like buzzing around, and that buzzing can last kind of 5 or 10 minutes, and it just seems to go. And as I've said before, the doors, the lack of a handle here somewhere to grip when you're opening the door can be a little bit annoying. Those are the main things, guys. So what are the positives, guys? Well, I think that the second-hand prices of these cars at the moment, at 54 to 56 grand, is phenomenal. Because the normal M4 comps with low mileage and high specs are now hitting 50 grand at the dealerships. So you're essentially, forgive me, I need to concentrate on my driving. You're essentially about 6 grand above a highly specced new M4 comp, you know, newish M4 comp, a dealer. I know you can get them a bit cheaper than that, but it's worth it for the carbon ceramics and that bonnet, which I'm told the bonnet is worth £8,000 if you have to replace it. And the carbon ceramics are an £8,000 option. So there's 16 grand's worth of upgrades, and that doesn't cover all the little Alcantara bits and all the other things that you get on the CS. So I think it's a second-hand proposition. It's really, really good, and it will hold its residuals. Now, the most important thing about this car is the fun factor. I want a car that tantalizes me, that I get in and it makes me smile and I get excited when I drive it. I want a car that scares me a little bit, keeps me respectful of the car, and if I drive like an idiot, the car might punish me, but when I learn how to drive the car will reward me. I know it sounds like a bit of a cliche, but that's what I want. If the car is too good at putting its power down, then they can feel a bit sterile, I think. So the greatest thing about this M4CS is the fun factor. And all of that power in the rear, once you learn to kind of feed it on and respect it, well, then you can have a hell of a lot of fun with this car. And I've owned it now for 3 or 4 months, and I'm telling you, I absolutely love it. Another big positive for me is the styling of this F82 M4 is beautiful. It just looks good from the front, it looks good from the rear, it looks good from the side, it looks good from the top. The alloy, these forged alloy wheels look amazing to me. The carbon ceramics look amazing to me. I love owning it, I love washing it, I love detailing it, which is part of the ownership experience for me. But most importantly, I love driving it. Now, I've mentioned and gone through all the flaws with this car. It's not going to be everyone's cup of tea. It is definitely going to be too brutal for a lot of people, too dangerous for some people. You know, that's not said disrespectfully. It's going to be too dangerous for certain people. It would have been too dangerous for me in my 20s. I'd have been dead within about 2 weeks of owning this car, first time I floored it. But like I say, if you like being on the edge of the seat, you are going to love the rawness of this car. This to me is a pure driver's car, and yes, the scariness and the lack of practicality, the fuel consumption, the aggressiveness is going to, and the lack of some features like somewhere to rest your arm, so after a couple of hours driving it you're going to be you know, you're a little bit uncomfortable. And yes, these M Sport bucket seats, they're nice and supportive, but after 2 or 3 hours, it will start to kind of play on your back a little bit. So I've captured everything there now, guys. What I'm gonna do is take you to the final conclusion of this video to tell you what the secret of life is. So, what was the secret of life? A little bit of danger. So, vive la France, vive la BMW, and vive la danger. What I